Okay, could I have your attention, please? Wow. Is that loud enough? Wow. I better not get excited, huh? Whoa. Okay, I may need to be turned down, don't I? So we don't get feedback. Good morning. How is everybody? Are you ready to do some mathematics? Whoa. So just a little bit of background. Dr. McDougall says, told you he wants to be thought of as a doctor, a general doctor. And of course, I'd like to be thought of as a general doctor too. But I'm actually also a math teacher. My first job out of college was to teach Algebra 1, Geometry, and Algebra 2. So be ready for this. How many like math? Oh, okay. Well, we'll be doing some multiple regression and the backflip. But really, this is less about math, and it's more about statistics. And by statistics, you know, it always sounds fancy, like it's going to be something about inferential statistics and p-values. But I really just mean the numbers that we use to describe benefits and harms. And I want to go through the two most misleading statistics in my business, which is relative change and the measurement of survival. So that's our plan. By relative change, I mean, you'll read in the newspaper or hear on the media about percent increases, percent decreases. And in medicine, we also use these ratio measures called relative risks or relative rates or hazard ratios or odds ratios. All these things tend to exaggerate the effect on both sides. It would tend to both exaggerate benefits, it would tend to exaggerate harms. They tend to be interpreted as bigger than they are. And then we'll talk about survival. And by survival, I'm really talking about what you normally hear as 5-year survival or 10-year survival proportions. And that also exaggerates the benefit of early detection. But it can, even worse, it can obscure the true effect. It can actually obscure a harm, and I'll talk a little bit about that. But let's start with relative change. So that's the overview. We got some doctors in the room. I know they've been hassling me. No, they haven't been, but and I'm very glad they're here. This is a question for the doctors in the room. Which is more important? A 30% reduction in LDL cholesterol, or B, a 30% reduction in diastolic blood pressure? Quickly, A or B, docs? Now, how the hell do you know which is better? I have no, yeah, you just assume it's got to be a right answer. Yeah, I mean, these are relative changes. You don't know where you began, and you don't know where you ended up. Right? I mean, a 30%, everyone wants to say B is more important. Well, what if I'm saying moving from 50 down to 20, you know, I mean, that's not good. There's not enough information here. It's just the change. Now, if I change that to a statement like this, a reduction in LDL cholesterol from 130 to 90, or a reduction of diastolic blood pressure from 130 to 90, now everybody says B. It's not complicated, because I've told you where we start and where we begin. Those are both 30% reductions. But you gotta have that underlying information. It's not enough just to hear what is typically the simpler number to put in an article or on a soundbite on television or on the radio. It's easy to talk about percent increases and percent decreases, but they don't tell you what you really wanna know. These are the absolute changes. So that's the language I'm going to be talking. Relative changes are percent increase, percent decrease. Absolute changes tell you where you begin and where you end. Now, everybody now, you don't have to be a doctor, which is more important, a 40% reduction in death or a 40% reduction in hip fracture? Quickly. Okay, because we all say death is the most important outcome. Well, maybe it is, maybe it isn't, depends, you know. Sometimes death is a blessing. All of you know that. So it depends on the setting. But I think most people would look and say, of course A is more important. But what if I showed you the absolute numbers? A reduction in death from 5 to 3 per thousand, or a reduction in hip fracture, which isn't a trivial issue, and in fact actually often starts the chain of events towards death, from 500 to 300 per thousand. Wow, that's 2 fewer deaths per thousand people versus 200 fewer hip fractures per thousand people. Well, now I think a lot of people would argue actually B is more important. If you're trying to help a population, B is more important. But the only way you know that is to have the underlying data, right? They're both 40% reductions. Trust me, if you don't have a calculator, they're both 40% reductions. But this is a reduction off a really big number, and this is a reduction off a relatively small number. But you don't get that information if all you see is the 40% reduction. All right, which is more important, a reduction in death from 8 to 4 per thousand, or a reduction in death from 20 to 16 per thousand? How many people say A? How many say B? How many don't like the game? Why don't you like the game? Because they're the same. They're the same, right? That's 4 fewer deaths per thousand, and that's 4 fewer deaths per thousand. That's why you don't like it. It's the exact same. But that's a 50% reduction. That's a 20% reduction, right? So that's the point. It's just not enough to know that relative change. So my point is to avoid being misled here. When you're presented with a relative change, if you're trying to learn about healthcare's effects or the effects of toxins in the environment or anything like that, it's not enough to get a relative change. You want to have the absolute change, where you start and where you end up. Now, the problem that I think most of you can probably relate to is imagine a 50% off sale. And I got two doors. How many remember Monty Hall? Oh, yeah, okay. I don't have room for a third door up there. There should be 3 doors. Door number 1 or door number 2, you're going to get 50% off. Which door do you want? 2? 1? Which do you want? Come on, you got to make a decision. It sounds like the ones have it. Okay, the ones have it. You got 50% off an iTunes. Oh, you're dead. Oh, sorry. Yeah, right. If you had picked door number 2, you get an iPad 2. Yeah, well, everybody wants an iPad 2. And you'd have to live on the planet Xenon not to realize that's more expensive than that. In fact, I just checked this yesterday. I think the suggested retail price now of the iPod 2 is about $500. The iTunes one song is now about $1.29. Of course, you'd rather have 50% off on the more expensive product. Unbelievably, just driving up here on 101, I was listening to the radio. I'm an old radio guy, and I like listening to local radio. And there's a hardware store running a 15% off sale this weekend. Do you know who it is? What is it? Merchants? Orchard Supply. Because I'd like to get this radio ad because it actually really lays out this problem very well. You know, it depends what you want 15%. It matters what you want 15% off of. And it's a wonderful ad. And I think it's something we can all understand, that percentage change is not sufficient in making the decision. A relative change provides no information about 50% off from what? Okay. Oh, this is a reminder. So I'm supposed to gauge the audience here. trying to think where you guys are at. Would you like to hear a little bit about ratio measures? Now, let me just give a little bit of introduction here. The medical literature, this move from the medical literature to media reporting to the public is a tough transition. It's not super tough, but it may be useful. The medical literature tends to talk about RRs, relative risks, relative rates, while the media reporting needs to translate that into percent higher and percent lower. Because these things are so ingrained in our literature, in fact, I showed you some last night, it may be useful for those of you who do want to go to PubMed, who do want to access our literature, to understand those ratio measures. So, should I do that or? Okay, we're going to go by volume here. Ratios are cut to the chase. I'm really happy to go either way. Okay, those who want to cut to the chase are welcome to tune out for 10 minutes. Okay, they're welcome to tune out. Let me just, for those who really want to access the medical literature, you do need to understand these ratio measures. And you need to understand a little bit of our language. And the generic medical research question looks something like this. Does the exposure to blank lead to the outcome of blank? And I want you to sort of have a feel for what I mean by those words, exposure and outcome. So our whole business, appropriately so, is about relating exposures to outcome. As researchers, we're interested in that question. So does asbestos lead to mesothelioma? Answer, it does. Does radon lead to lung cancer? It probably does, but it's kind of weak. Do cell phones lead to brain cancer? No, it doesn't. But those are the kind of questions we're asking. Now, when most of us hear the word exposure, we think about something that's bad because it's associated with a bad outcome. And all those things, the concern is those might be concerning. But I want you to broaden your idea of what I mean by an exposure. In medical research, an exposure is not necessarily bad. It's just something that may be associated with a change in outcome, either for better or for worse. So we would say aspirin's an exposure that reduces the rate of heart attack. Not a lot, but about 10%. Flu vaccine, we're interested in that as an exposure to its relationship with pneumonia death. And it doesn't look like it's very powerful at that at all. Home care, is it associated with changes in patient satisfaction? We consider home care an exposure. Preventive care, is that associated with lower or higher health care costs? I mean, again, we're considering an exposure. So I just want you to understand the word exposure has a very broad meaning in medicine. It's about something we're interested in, what effect it has on outcome. So, the most common measure of relative change in our literature is the relative risk. And it's a ratio of two risks. And risk means simply a probability. It's the risk in the exposed, those that are exposed to the intervention, the treatment, the toxin, over the risk in the unexposed. So it can be the risk in an intervention versus a control group, a risk in those taking a drug versus the risk of those taking a placebo, a risk of those exposed to toxin and a risk of those not exposed to a toxin, or a risk in a specified group and a risk in a referent group. We make ratios. And the key to understanding a ratio is to understand what's in the denominator. What are you comparing it to? What are you comparing it to? So a relative risk is this ratio of one absolute risk and one other absolute risk. An absolute risk in the exposed versus an absolute risk in the unexposed. But once you do the division, you've lost the numerator and the denominator. Once you do the division, you've lost that information. You had to have it, but you put it together, that's a relative risk. So to interpret a relative risk, we say a relative risk greater than one means that the exposure, whatever it is, intervention, toxin, new therapy, increases the chance of the outcome. That's because it's the top number. That's the risk in the exposed group relative to the unexposed group. A relative risk less than one means the exposure, again, intervention, toxin, new therapy, decreases the chance of the outcome. And a relative risk of one means that the exposure, intervention, toxin, new therapy, has no relationship to the outcome. It's the same in both the numerator and the denominator. So now, I just want you to think about how it will look. It will say there'll be an RR of 0.8 for heart disease following new therapy versus those in the control group. And the way to think about that is patients taking new therapy have blank times the risk of heart disease as the control group. What number should be in the blank? 0.8, right? That's all. You can make it a statement like that. Patients taking new therapy have 0.8 times the risk of heart disease as controls. Now this one's easy. Relative risk of 10, that's actually low, it's probably closer to 20, for lung cancer in smokers versus non-smokers. Fill in the blank. Smokers have the risk of lung cancer as non-smokers. RR of 1.5 for cancer in patients taking new drug versus those not taking it. Yeah, some of our drugs increase the risk of cancer. So, patients taking new drug have 1.5 times the risk of cancer of those not taking it. And here's the last one, RR 0.4 for stroke in patients taking new drug versus placebo. Patients taking new drug have 0.4 times the risk of stroke versus those taking placebo. Now, it's a little clunky, isn't it? A reporter isn't going to write that. Patients taking new therapy have 0.8 times the risk of heart disease as control. You're never going to see that in the newspaper. You're never going to see that in an article for the general public. It's just too clunky. So it gets transformed. It gets transformed to this statement. Patients taking new therapy have a 20% decreased risk. That's how you get to that relative change. It looks like that. Smokers have 10 times the risk of lung cancer as non-smokers. Everybody gets that, right? That's an easy one, and people will write it like that. But patients taking new drugs has 1.5 times the risk of cancer as those not taking it. That's kind of clunky, too. You know, people don't like decimals in a sentence. People don't like decimals at all, you know. So that's written typically like this. Patients taking new drug have a 50% increased risk. And the last one, totally clunky, 0.4 times, you know, that's going to be transformed as well. That's going to be written, patients taking new drug have a 60% decreased incidence of stroke. Now, interpreting a relative risk less than one, how does that all happen? And here's the hardest math for you today. The percentage decrease is 1 minus the RR. And then you make it into a percent. So an RR of 0.8 is a 20% decrease in risk. Here's the math. The RR is 0.80. I'm going to subtract 1 minus 0.8. And that gives me 0.2. That's a 20% decrease. Oh, you get it? An RR 0.7 is a 30% decrease. 1 minus 0.7 is 0.3. That's a 30% decrease. RR 0.67, who's sharp? All right, 33% decrease. RR 0.9? Okay, so now you're getting it. That is what's happening as we move from these ratio measures to the percent increase and percent decrease. 0.75? Okay, so everybody gets that. Now let me get back to the big picture. I just wanted you to know how those ratio measures get expressed in the general public. And that's correct. What the math they're doing is correct. But let's come back to the big picture. Is those relative risks hide the absolute risk? So consider this, a risk of a bad event, something we care about, heart attacks, strokes, cancer, whatever. If you don't take action, it happens in 500 per 1,000. If you do take actions, it happens in 300 per 1,000. That's a relative risk of 0.6, 300 over 500. Now here's 100 per thousand versus 60 per thousand. That's also a relative risk of 0.6. And in the third case, I'm going to say 5 per thousand versus 3 per thousand. That's also 0.6. They all have the same relative risk. So the statement of relative risk reduction, what's it going to be for a 0.6? 40%, right? Those are all 40% decreases. But the absolute risk reduction, that's 200 fewer, right? 500 versus 300. This one's 40 fewer. This one's 2 fewer. Yet they all look the same in terms of a relative risk. They all look the same. They all look like a 40% decrease. And let me go through one more, totally the mirror image problem. Consider here, no action, 1 in 1,000 experience something bad. If you take an action, no one does. That's an undefined, that's an RR of 0. B, 5 per 1,000 to 4 per 1,000, that's 0.8. C, 500 per 1,000 versus 499 per 1,000, that's a relative risk of 0.998. Hugely different. Hugely different. Relative risk reduction, that's 100% decrease. That's a 20% decrease. That's a 0.2% decrease. Looks tiny. But what? They're all the same, right? They're all 1 fewer per 1,000. Now let me show you how this really plays out. And this is from an effort to educate women about the utility of tamoxifen as a way to prevent breast cancer, not as a way to treat it. So I'm not questioning the use of it as a way to treat it. This is a way to prevent it. And the National Cancer Institute had this presentation. They said, as the trial found, that taking tamoxifen led to a 50% reduction in the number of breast cancers. Whether these cancers were important cancers or not, different question. But they pointed out the drug had a side effect. Endometrial cancers increased from 5 to 13 per 1,000 over 5 years. What's the problem with this presentation? It's what? It's mixed. Right? There's two different frames. Everybody see there's two different frames? How do you think patients react? Do they say, oh, this is a good deal or a bad deal? They say it's a good deal. Why? Because that 50%, that's the one they understand quickly, big effect. And that, hell, we all have trouble with 5 per 1,000, 13 per 1,000. That just feels like noise. That's a relative change. That's an absolute change. So, what's Welch's presentation? The Welch's presentation is this. Breast cancer is reduced from 43 to 22 per 1,000 over 5 years, and more than double the rate of endometrial cancer. How would patients react now? Oh, double the rate of endometrial cancer. I don't understand that top one. But double the rate, so it really matters. That framing really, really matters. That's an absolute change here. That's a relative change. Now, of course, that's not fair. They're both equally unfair. And I could make it a useless balanced frame. This would be totally useless. 50% fewer breast cancers, 2.6-fold increase in endometrial cancer. That really doesn't help you because you don't know where you started and where you began. The balanced frame is this. Breast cancer is 43 to 22. Endometrial cancer is 5 to 13. And so you can see the trade-off is maybe you get 3 less breast cancers, 1 more endometrial cancer. Something like now you can really begin to understand the trade-off. So that's relative change. Think about getting the absolute numbers, where you begin and where you end up. Now we'll move on to survival. 5-year survival, 10-year survival, where it not only exaggerates the benefit of early detection, but can actually obscure a true effect of harm. Now this was a recent press release. Mammography may be beneficial to all women regardless of age. In women who are 80 years or older, the five-year survival rate for breast cancer patients was 82% among those who did not use mammography, and 94% among those who did. So this is for the general public, this is out there, and like, how complicated is that? Of course I want mammography, right? I mean, the message is totally clear. If survival's a good thing, if you want to live, of course you want mammography. But there's real, real problems with this comparison. What is wrong with concluding that mammography is working? Who wants to take a shot at that? Anybody want to take a shot? What's wrong?
We don't know how many.
We don't know how many. Okay. Other things? We don't know what they die of. Okay. This is actually breast cancer survival. Yeah. Okay, we don't know where the mammography found their cancer. You don't? Anything else bother you?
They're 80 years old.
They're 80 years old. That bothers you. Well, we'll all be 80 sometime, but there are other health issues. Yeah, that's true. But there's actually two big problems with this statement. First, it's not randomized. It's not randomized. And women who choose to be screened may be systematically different from those who do not. In fact, one thing we know is most people who choose to be screened are, in fact, much healthier than people who choose not to be screened or who are not screened. And in fact, sick patients have a lot of other things to do with their doctor besides looking for a new problem, right? And in fact, in the most recent major randomized trial of screening that involved over 100,000 people from the federal government, the PLCO, prostate, lung, colon and ovary trial, they found that the people who were volunteered for the trial had cancer death rates half that of the general population for cancers they weren't even screening for. They were fundamentally a very healthy population. So a comparison like this, people who choose to be screened versus people who don't choose to be screened, all of a sudden you have very different groups from the start. Now, that's a problem where you just don't have comparable groups. But there's a second problem. The statistic is biased. All survival statistics, all of them, are biased by early detection. They're influenced in ways that are understood and can only move one direction. They can only move up. And I want to show you why. Survival always rises with cancer screening. If mortality falls, that's a good thing. Death rate going down, survival will rise. If mortality is unchanged, survival will rise. If mortality rises, survival will rise. Survival always rises following cancer screening. And in the next half hour, I want to make sure you understand why. Because that's really important. You hear these statistics all the time. Survival will always exaggerate the benefit of cancer screening. Why? One, for a screening test to work, for it to work, it has to cause patients to be diagnosed earlier than they would be otherwise. That makes sense. That's the first fundamental criteria for screening. It must advance the time of diagnosis. So, in other words, a screening test must introduce what we call a lead time. It must find the cancers earlier than they would present to the doctor otherwise. And the minute you've got lead time, and lead time's a good thing, I mean, it's the first thing a screening test has got to do, it introduces a lead time bias. Okay, what's he talking about? How a lead time bias can increase survival even if there's been no prolongation in life. Imagine in the world without screening, the typical death for a breast cancer patient, which it is about now, the median death, is about age 69. If a patient is diagnosed at age 65, how long has that woman lived? Are you sure? Is this hard? Anybody need a cup of coffee or anything? Okay, it's four years, right? So their contribution to five-year survival is zero. She did not live 5 years. But now, with screening, let's say the same patient still dies at 69, But she's diagnosed the lead time of the screening test at age 60. How long has this patient lived? So she is a, you know, she counts as a 100% 5-year survival. Do you see the problem? Right? We assume that a prolonged survival means a delay in death, but it may mean just an advancing in the time of diagnosis. All right. Consider these 10 patients with clinically diagnosed cancer. This patient is clinically diagnosed at this point, lives 8 years, and dies. This patient is clinically diagnosed, lives 2.5 years, and then dies. This patient, 4 years, and so forth. I'm going to put 10 patients up there. And now everybody ought to really be paying attention, because there's a question coming. What's the 5-year survival in this population? It's going to be a percentage. What's it going to be expressed at? 30%. How'd you do that? You looked for those arrows that are 5 years or longer. So the 5-year survival, those are the three arrows out of 10. I didn't hear any thank you for making the denominator 10. You know, I work at this. I'd like to have a little, I'd like to feel the love here, or else I'm going to give you 13. I could make it 13, and then you'd really want a calculator. Okay. So the 5-year survival is 3 over 10, or 30%. Everybody see that? Now, the question is, let's add some lead time. Let's advance the time of diagnosis. And the typical lead time with mammography is believed to be about 2 years. So, and by the way, I'm using mammography as an example, but this is true for any screening test, adding the lead time. So that 8-year person gets 2 years of lead time. So has now survived 10 years from diagnosis. This one is now 4.5. This one's now 6. This one's now 3. And you see what's happening, right? I'm adding the lead time. I'm making the diagnosis early. We measure survival from the time of diagnosis. What's the new 5-year survival?
7%.
Oh, yeah. That's what I like. Because there's 7 arrows that now extend more than 5 years. 5-year survival is 7 over 10, or 70%. But nothing's changed about the time of death. Now, I'm not saying screening can't change the time of death. I'm just telling you the generic problem that guarantees no matter what the real effect is, survival will go higher. So you've got to be very skeptical the minute you hear the benefit of early detection being expressed in terms of the statistic survival. Of course it's higher because you advance the time of diagnosis. And it's hard because the way we think about language needs to change. When we hear survival, and I suffer from this too, you hear survival, you assume it means a delay in death, right? You hear longer survival, you assume, well, that means death's been pushed back. But in fact, it may simply mean earlier diagnosis. That's the problem. So it's a biased statistic in the setting of early detection. Of course, early detection is going to lengthen survival. That's the first problem. Believe it or not, I learned about that in medical school. This has been known 30, 40 years. This is old stuff, lead time bias. It's 101 effective screening. We know there's a lead time bias in screening because the only way screening can work is to introduce a lead time. The second problem is more recent. Because screening tests attempt to find some preclinical disease, some degree of overdiagnosis, what I was talking to you about last night, is probably the rule, not the exception. And in fact, we're at a place now where we less debate about whether or not overdiagnosis occurs. The question is, how often does it occur? Overdiagnosis bias results from pseudodisease, literally false disease. I'll tell you a little bit more about that. Inflating both the numerator and the denominator of the survival statistic. That's hard. I know that's hard. Inflating numerator and denominator, how does that work? I showed you this slide last night, right? That the whole idea of early detection was to advance the time of diagnosis But the reality is when we did that, we got more patients, right? We got more patients. And that natural history now is a little bit more complex. Hopefully, we've gotten those that are destined to develop a symptomatic cancer, although unfortunately sometimes we miss those because they're so fast growing. But at the general problem, we've got this other group not destined to develop symptoms. Now, how does that play into survival? These are the older, overdiagnosed and needlessly treated. It's an uncomfortable reality that this pathologic diagnosis, how the pathologists diagnose cancer, encompasses a wide variety of abnormalities. The familiar is cellular abnormalities, which if left untreated, will progress to cause death. That's the word cancer that we all are familiar with and are scared about. But the unfamiliar are things that meet this pathologic definition of cancer, but they do not progress, or they may even regress. And so I want to show you that cancer is really a very heterogeneous set of disorders. And on the y-axis, I'm going to show you the size of the cancer. And imagine that cancer starts with an abnormal cell. And I know it starts at the genomic level, but we'll start at the cellular level. At some point, it gets large enough to cause symptoms. And then at some point, it gets large enough to cause death. And there's a second dimension here, which is time. But that time is bounded at the point that people die from something else. Everybody dies, right? So that's the bounding part of this. And now that I've sort of set up this graph, I can talk about the heterogeneity of cancer progression. That's a fast-growing cancer, right? It starts as an abnormal cell. It quickly goes on to cause symptoms, and it quickly goes on to cause death. And the uncomfortable reality is our screening tests tend to miss these cancers. Why? Because they're growing so fast, they happen in the interval between screening tests. This is a slow-growing cancer. It goes on to cause symptoms. It goes on to cause death. Arguably, this is where screening will have its biggest effect. This is a very slowly growing cancer. It's growing. But it's doing so slowly, it never causes symptoms before the patient dies of other causes. That's the story for most prostate cancers. That's prostate cancers where we began to worry about this problem. And then we have actually non-progressive cancers, things that meet the cellular definition of cancers but ultimately never progress. And then even more odd, we actually have cancers that regress. And it's something about the host-tumor interaction that we seem to be able to deal with some small cancers. Now, when we look for cancer early, we tend to pick up a lot of this stuff. And cancer overdiagnosis, another way to think about it, is detecting any one of these. Something that's never ultimately going to cause the patient problems. But if we look early, that's how we find these things. And they have been dubbed, not by me, but by others, as pseudo-disease, literally false disease. And I kind of like that word because disease is something a patient will experience. And this is pseudo-disease because the patient will never experience it. So as we look harder for cancer, we always find more. Some of it meets the cancer that meets this pathologic definition of cancer will never progress to cause symptoms or death. The detection of pseudo-disease is what overdiagnosis is about in cancer. So now let's come back to survival. What does this do to survival statistics? How overdiagnosis bias can increase survival even if there's been no change in the number of deaths. So imagine in the past you diagnosed 1,000 patients with progressive prostate cancer. It's the real deal. This is before screening. And 5 years later, 400 are alive. What's the five-year survival here? 40%, right? The five-year survival is going to be 400 over 1,000, or 40%. Now, after screening, we find the same 1,000 patients with progressive prostate cancer, because they were going to show up anyway. But we also find 1,000 patients with prostate cancer pseudo-disease that's never going to cause death. 5 years later, we've got the deaths we did before. Now, this is hard. What's the 5-year survival now? 20%? Well, we got a little bit of variation here. The numerator is 1,400, right? There are 1,400 patients alive now, right? We've got this 1,000 and that 1,400. So, and that 400, so that's 1,400. The denominator is everybody, so that's 2,000, and it's 70%. But nothing has changed in terms of the number of people who've died. How many people have died on each side? 600. So survival's gone up incredibly, but the same number of people have died. You know, there's 600 deaths here, 2,000 minus 1,400, 1,000 minus 400, there's 600 deaths over there. So now I'll come back to that language I was using before. Overdiagnosis bias, pseudodisease inflates both the numerator and the denominator. In the old case, it was 400 over 1,000 or 40%. We're going to inflate that numerator by the 1,000 cases of pseudodisease. That makes it 1,400. We're going to inflate that denominator by the 1,000 patients of pseudodisease, right? Because they both count as a cancer and they survive. And all of a sudden, you got 1,400 over 2,000 or 70%. But nothing's changed. You've got 600 deaths on either side. The doctors asked for a CME quiz. This is an important part of our continuing medical education. And to get credit, you have to take a quiz. So here it goes. Which is the fastest way to improve cancer survival rates? Pick one. A, high-dose radiation followed by autologous bone marrow transplantation. Anybody voting for that? B, high-dose NIH funding. C, have every man, woman, and child donate $50 to the American Cancer Society. Or D, give every man, woman, and child a cancer diagnosis. Now, sometimes D, that extreme, which is crazy, helps you understand the problem, right? If we give everybody a cancer diagnosis, survival will skyrocket, and we assume something good's happening. I mean, just think about it. After giving everyone a cancer diagnosis, there's 100,000 men, that makes it 100,400, you know, that makes it, you know, that's 99.999%. If you have a lot of pseudodisease, it has an incredibly powerful effect on survival statistics. By the way, measured prostate cancer survival in this country is 5-year survival is 100% now. Almost like it's not cancer. Why? Because there's so much diagnosis going on. So I'll give you a couple of clinical examples of how these two biases combine to suggest dramatic effects from early detection when little or none is present. Lung cancer, prostate cancer, and then trends among the 20 most common cancers in the SEER database. I'm going to start with an old randomized trial from the 1980s, the Mayo Clinic trial of chest x-ray screening for lung cancer. And there's two groups. They're about the same size, about 4,500 patients in each group. These are smokers. Some are getting chest x-rays every 4 months. The other are getting your usual care. Here's the number diagnosed with lung cancers. These are similar size groups, 206 versus 160. What does that mean? What does that mean about chest x-ray? Well, it means that x-rays can find more disease. You look harder, you find more. The percent that are early stage, 40% of those 206 are early stage as compared to 26% of the 160 are early stage. So what does that mean? Well, that means that x-rays can find early disease. Big surprise, right? So x-rays can find more, and what do they find? They find more early stage disease. Here's the 5-year survival reported back in the mid-80s, 35% versus 19%. That was pretty dramatic. Wow, this is a really important test. What does that mean? Well, it really means that lung cancer patients live longer following diagnosis. But again, it doesn't tell you whether death's been delayed or whether the time of diagnosis has been advanced. The lung cancer death rate, wow. It's higher in the chest x-ray group. It's higher in the chest x-ray group. What does that mean? It means that people die of lung cancer at a slightly higher rate following early diagnosis. If you just looked at the five-year survival statistic, you would be totally misled. You have to know that improved survival is totally the result of these two biases I told you about, the lead time and the overdiagnosis. Oh, and I didn't want to show you the journal that wrote this article, but this problem persists. You know, the article reported that lung cancer diagnosed by CT had a 10-year survival approaching 90% and invites the comparison to general practice, all the rest of the idiot doctors out there whose 5-year survival is, 10-year survival is 10%. It's a totally biased comparison, totally biased. Doesn't tell you what you want to know. This doesn't mean anyone had their life extended or death delayed. These data are perfectly compatible with patients having their life shortened by the process. Now let's talk about prostate cancer. 5-year survival in prostate cancer. In 1950, it was 43%. In 1970, it's 63%. In 1980, it's 75%. In 2000, it was 98%. And now it's really 100%. But I'm just going to talk about from 1950 to 2000 because nominally, there was this dramatic increase. That's a huge increase, 43 to 98%. Huge increase. There's no cancer with a faster rising 5-year survival than prostate cancer. The dramatic increase in 5-year survival, but mortality was relatively flat. It's come down since then, but for this period, nominally, there was absolutely no change in mortality. And so you say, gosh, how can that be? Well, it's because that number of new cases, first during the TURP era, this was the when we did this operation to help men go to the bathroom, the transurethral prostatectomy, which brought little chips of prostate out, and the pathologist started looking at them and saw a lot of cancer. Incidence went up about 60%. And then boom, the PSA era that I showed you last night, an incredible increase in the number of patients. So you put that together, you look at the area under that curve, it's well over 1 million patients, and you know what? Those newly diagnosed patients, they do really well. They weren't destined to die from their prostate cancer. They had, most of them had pseudo disease, and that is what's driving that 5-year survival statistic. That goes up so dramatically, but that improvement is largely, again, the combined effect of the lead time and overdiagnosis problem. Why do I say that? Because in fact, over this period, mortality didn't change at all. In the context of cancer screening, survival is a remarkably misleading word. It's so tempting, and we all have to think about it, when we hear increased survival, to equate that with extended life or delayed death. We tend to equate it that way, but that's not necessarily true. In the context of cancer screening, survival is a remarkably misleading metric. You think that a survival rate would be something like 1 minus a mortality rate, but it's not. You'd think a higher survival rate would mean a lower mortality rate, but that's not true, not necessarily true. And let me just end with showing you kind of the whole shebang, a paper I did with my colleagues about 6 years ago, looking at how changes in 5-year survival and the 20 most common cancers in the United States, solid tumors, how they correlated with changes in mortality. And so on the y-axis, I'm going to show you what happened to each cancer in terms of its absolute increase in 5-year survival. And the one thing you now know is, in fact, all cancers survive. For all cancers, survival is increasing, all of them. And then on the x-axis, I'll do the percent change in mortality. And now you see that mortality moves both directions. There's an area where there's lower mortality, and there's an area where there's higher mortality. Now I'll start put a cancer up here. This is what we just talked about. This is prostate cancer. Over this period, from 2000, since 1950. Prostate cancer mortality didn't change, but its five-year survival went up 50%, from 43 to 93%. You know, unbelievable. That's what happened with prostate cancer. Here's breast cancer. A little bit lower mortality, but a dramatic increase in survival. Here's testicular cancer. Well, now this is the way we'd sort of like things to look, right? Dramatically higher survival, and in fact, dramatically lower mortality. So that sort of works like we'd expect it. And here's lung cancer. Not much change in survival, and in fact, mortality is going up. That sort of makes sense. Well, here's melanoma. Wow, since 1950, its mortality actually went up. It did it between 1950 and about 1970. But its five-year survival's increased dramatically. That's crazy. How can that be? And then here's stomach cancer. Its mortality has dropped more than any other cancer in the United States. Stomach cancer is an incredible story. It's now at one-fifth the rate it would have been in 1950. But guess what? Its survival hasn't changed at all. It has just about the same survival. Pretty much the same thing for cervical cancer, a very small change in survival, but a dramatic effect in mortality. And I won't go through the other 20. I'll just plot them there for you so you kind of see the picture. And what's amazing to me, and probably the reason I was able to get this article published, is because there's absolutely no correlation between changes in five-year survival and changes in mortality. There's absolutely no correlation over this period. So higher survival rate does not mean a lower mortality rate. So I'm talking about five-year survival being the world's most misleading cancer statistic. I could be talking about 10-year survival. I could be talking about 7.5-year survival. Survival is a misleading statistic in the context of early detection. And let me just show you the algebra here of these two numbers, because now at least I've hoped that I've motivated you to say, gosh, there's something different about a death rate than a survival rate. And I hope you are ready to say, gosh, I'd like to decompose these two measures. They each have a numerator and they have a denominator. Five-year survival is the cancer patient's alive 5 years after diagnosis. The denominator is cancer patients. So the denominator is cancer patients. The numerator is how many of them are alive 5 years later. Mortality rate is the number of cancer deaths over the entire population. Wow, those are totally different measures, aren't they? And in fact, this is expressed, unfortunately, in numbers that people are very comfortable with, 30%, 50%, 70%. This is expressed in numbers everyone's uncomfortable with, 24 per 100,000. That's the breast cancer death rate in this country. Hard numbers, so you don't tend to get it in the newspaper, don't tend to get it, but it's the important number. Unfortunately, because survival is sort of such a familiar number, percent, it's much more often to be reported. The real difference is this denominator. It's about the population as a whole versus cancer patients. And the problem with early detection is it changes who's there and the time they get there. The changes who's there, that's the overdiagnosis problem, inflating both the numerator and the denominator. The time they get there, that's the lead time problem. It's all sensitive to that denominator. So how to avoid being misled? Relative change, find the absolute change, where you start, where you ended up. For survival, ignore the statistic when assessing the value of early detection. It is hopelessly biased. Thank you for your attention. I'll be happy to answer any questions. You did good with the math. I know that was a hard. We were working you this morning. We wanted to make sure you got some statistics in.
Okay, if you could come back here for questions, I appreciate it.
Thank you. Your presentation was great.
Thank you.
My question is, you are one of the leading analysts of this situation. Which diseases or conditions do you recommend screening for? What is your bottom line with your particular biases and backgrounds?
Well,
We're cutting to the bottom line.
Yeah, you're cutting to the bottom line. I want to be clear about my general feeling first so people understand. I think these are very close calls, and I think we need to tell people just how close they are. And I don't think people are crazy to be screened if they understand the deal. And I also don't think they're crazy not to be screened if they understand the deal. And fundamentally, there's a value judgment involved. The trade-off is a very, very small chance of changing your risk of death, a vanishingly small and actually hard to measure. And I want to be clear, it's so hard to measure, that's why we have to have studies with literally tens, hundreds of thousands of people followed for 10 years. And just a reminder, in the hypertension example I showed you last night, we only needed 150 men followed for 1.5 years. So we're looking for really, so the benefit is small. The harms are more common. They're definitely more common. But it becomes a value judgment of how you weigh those harms, right? They're apples and oranges. There's no amount of statistics, computers that fundamentally can judge how people feel about it. So I think in many ways, we have to recognize that screening is a preference-sensitive decision. Now that said, what do I recommend? Prostate cancer screening, I'm now on record as describing it as an awful deal. It's really hard, I think, for patients to understand what impotence, incontinence, and radiation proctitis is like. It's hard for the general public to understand. And it's just so much more common than the potential death benefit that I don't think we should really even be offering it anymore. Mammography is closer. The harms of treatment aren't quite as dramatic as the harms of a radical prostatectomy. And the overdiagnosis problem is probably somewhat smaller. I don't think it has a very useful effect. I've said, as I said last night, I don't think it should be something we're measuring. I don't think it's something that doctors should be stuck sort of pushing women into because their healthcare system has decided this is a measure of performance. I feel very strongly about that. But I do think it's a close call. Colon cancer screening. I've stayed away from colon cancer screening in part because colon cancer screening doesn't have the overdiagnosis of cancer problem. There's not a lot of extra cancers being found by colon cancer screening. The overdiagnosis is happening at a step ahead. Almost everybody has polyps. That's an overstatement, but about half of us have polyps. And people get stuck in this loop of very, very frequent colonoscopies. And I don't think there's a lot of extra surgery going on, meaning colectomy. In fact, the colectomy rates are going down. And that's what I'm most concerned about as harm, is too much treatment. So I feel that colon cancer is one of our better actors, although we really need to get better at not doing so much surveillance. And in fact, we're engaged in a randomized trial right now asking the question of whether colonoscopy is really any better than the one things we really have studied, which is fecal occult blood testing. Those are the three common cancers that have really been carefully evaluated in randomized trials. Now, there's a lot of opportunistic screening going on, and that's just where people are sort of saying, yeah, well, let's do this. Let's check your neck. Let's do a skin exam. Here, I think we're not informed about the effects of this. And I agree with Dr. McDougall here. That's on us. That's on us. It's up to us to provide data before we start doing things to people. And I think the moral imperative here is highest when we intervene on the well. Of course, with sick people, sometimes we try things. I don't think we should be trying things on the well. I think we should know what their effects are.
I was thinking more of blood pressure, blood sugar, and pap smears.
Okay, so let's talk about cervical cancer screening, which is a little bit of a place where beliefs are extremely strong that the reason we've seen, and we have seen a dramatic drop in cervical cancer mortality. Let's be clear, that's a good thing. That is a great thing. Everyone's been on a jump to attribute that all to screening. I don't think that's right. I think screening's had some effect, but I think there's a much more basic population effect going on that I cannot explain well. But the one thing I want to remind everybody is we've seen equally dramatic changes in stomach cancer mortality, a cancer we do not screen for, have never tried to screen for. So remember, things do change over time. You can't always assume it's the result of the medical care profession. As far as blood pressure and blood sugar, I think it's useful for people to know what their blood pressure is at some point, because high blood pressure, I think, is a problem. It's a problem in relatively few patients, but it's a good thing to know about. Whether you need to go to a doctor for that or whether you can just do it with a home monitor is a different thing. And type 2 diabetes is largely a lifestyle disease, and it's people who are overweight. And there, I think we should deal with the problem at hand.
Thank you.
Wow, that was a long list. Yes, sir.
I would like to take this last gentleman's question and ask the same question of you, except instead of applying the question to our general population, I'd like to ask you the same question applied to Seventh-day Adventist population, where the burden of disease is demonstrably lower.
Well, let me, this is without my projecting myself on another group. I'm not Seventh-day Adventist. I can't speak for their preference set. And I really do believe what people want matters here and how they value these things. So I won't pretend to be able to make judgments about exactly how they might react, whether they would feel more importantly like, I don't want to be medicalized unnecessarily, or I want to do everything I can to achieve a death benefit. I mean, people are on a spectrum here, and I talk about that spectrum in the book, that this is something we all have to ask ourselves, you know, do we want to pursue health and assume we're healthy as long as we feel well? That's sort of one extreme. Or do we want to pursue disease, which is, you know, hoping to do anything we can to live longer with the knowledge that that may lead to excessive medicalization and harm. So that's a preference question, and that's a question where I would guess Seventh-day Adventists tend to be on the pursue health side. But the one thing I will say is the people who stand to benefit the most from early detection are people who are at the highest risk of developing the cancer or the disease in question. So people who are relatively low risk stand to gain less. And yet the harms, again, that's not like that spectrum thing I was showing you, the harms are probably the same, are relatively the same. So the net deal is actually worse the lower you are. I'd never be, by the way, let's talk about lung cancer screening. I would never be screened for lung cancer. I'm a non-smoker, although some people are suggesting non-smokers be screened for, because lung cancer is actually still, in the big picture, a relatively important source of cancer mortality for non-smokers. But I'd never be screened for it. I'm at too low a risk to warrant all the downstream harms of needle biopsies and lung removal and so forth. So your baseline risk does matter. And the lower you risk you are of developing these diseases, the less you can benefit from early detection. Does that help?
Yeah.
Okay.
Would you recommend to people, before having a routine colonoscopy, they tell the doctor if you find a polyp, if it's greater than a certain size, clip it. If it's smaller than a certain size, don't clip it. And if so, what's a guideline for the size?
Yeah. Let me tell you something I learned in medical school, and that is the importance of saying, I don't know. I mean, I think it's important to be clear about what we don't know, I'm now reacting to the size threshold question. What is the size threshold we should be taking out of polyp versus what? I don't know. What I do know is that size threshold's too low now. I'm confident of that. And as a general rule, I think we could make screening a better deal. And I think it's, you know, we're obligated to think about making it a better deal. And the way we'd make it a better deal is to lower the overdiagnosis problem. And the way to lower the overdiagnosis problem is to raise the threshold to call things abnormal. We're looking too hard. For 20 years in prostate cancer, we've been looking too hard. And everyone assumes that the best cancer test is the one that finds the most cancers. That's not right. The best cancer test is the one that finds the right cancers, the ones that are ultimately going to matter. So your question is very much appreciated. Yes, we should have a higher threshold to diagnose things as abnormal, to biopsy things, and to remove things. What exactly the right threshold is, I don't know.
And maybe that is a lead into my question, because last night Dr. McDougall was talking about us practicing self-defense in our healthcare. But if I'm not a physician or a healthcare practitioner, I am relying on CNN or the Today Show or Good Morning America physicians to do that review of the literature or even a meta-analysis and interpret the findings and then telling me what the results of these screenings should be and what I should do. And typically these media physicians are just recommending what the general healthcare community right. considers standard care or standard practices.
Right.
So what am I
they
to
do? They don't
want to
deviate from the mean. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And even NIH funding and peer reviewers
yeah.
don't want to think out of the box in mm-hmm. studies that might contradict what is the general standard of care or practice. So what do we do as like lay people or as consumers of healthcare to make a judgment? Give us like the top three things to do.
Yeah. Well, I think one is to recognize that it does involve judgments on everybody's part, right? So judgments are being made and people are making people need to do the best they can, acknowledging that the data are limited, they may be conflicting, and so forth. I think one of the things we all need to do is to think about what our relationship with medical care is. What relationship we want to have with medical care, why we're well. Again, I'm a conventionally trained physician. My comments are not about when you're acutely sick, and this is another place where you and I agree. This is where doctors do their best work, is with people who are acutely sick, in trauma, infectious disease, and so forth. My questions are about what is your relationship with the medical care system when you are well? And that's something you have to explore with yourself, recognizing you're never going to have perfect data to make that decision. But we're realizing there's sort of this trade-off between you pursuing health and presuming everything's well versus this other extreme, which is you're pursuing disease and you're asking to be looking for every abnormality there is. And I'm not saying you have to be at one pole or the other. I just want to lay out that spectrum for you so we all start dealing with that and we understand the problems on both ends. Maybe if you pursue health, you miss some small opportunity to lengthen your life, while if you pursue disease, you face a much higher risk of a different problem, of being over-medicalized and over-treatment. We all have to sort of begin to think how we want to think about that. And then you need to communicate that with your doctor. And I think there are more doctors now who are open to hearing that. I'm not saying everyone, but there are more and more doctors who are open to hearing that. In fact, may even be relieved when they hear that patients don't want to pursue every abnormality, don't want to undergo every test. Now, we have this additional complexity in mammography, which is what I keep coming back to, of them being measured on how many people what proportion of the population is getting it. And we ought to fight that. We ought to say that is a really coercive and misguided kind of effort to measure healthcare quality. But I do encourage people to share, once they think about this, with their doctor how they'd like to be cared for. And remember, you are the patient. You know, what you want matters. It really does matter.
Well, I think we'd all agree that the best option is to get out of the medical business. And the best way to do that is to be healthy. That aside, you and I have been in this business for a long time. Are you hopeful? Do you think that finally people are going to do the honest thing?
Yeah. In my world, I actually am hopeful that there's now a broader recognition of this problem of overdiagnosis. And as I said a few minutes ago, you know, it used to be, does it happen or does it not? And now the discussions are much more about how often does it happen. People now understand this is a general issue. When you look for disease early, there's going to be a certain degree of overdiagnosis. And what becomes important is how often and how do people feel about it and so forth. I do think that there's a growing realization that medical care in general has been too aggressive. And that this simple idea that more is always better is beginning to be questioned more broadly in the population. What I hope is we can continue to question, we can continue to ask those questions without throwing the baby out with the bathwater. And I think we can, but it's a delicate thing. I'm an eternal optimist, but honestly, I'm the last few years, more reporters understand the problem, more of the public understands the problem, and in fact, even within the medical profession, there's more agreement that we've got to get out of this box.
Well, Dr. Welch, thank you for bringing such valuable information to us. Without any question, you enhance the life of everybody in this room.
Oh, thank you.
And we appreciate it very much. Thank you.
It's been an honor to be here. Thank you.
All right, we're going to take about a 15-minute break.